Lawns. Even if you're clear-eyed enough to see how unnecessary a dumb carpet of grass is to the quality of your life, your nosy neighbors or your homeowners association are usually not sympathetic to your views. Change is slow. So in the meantime, if you absolutely must have a lawn-ish thing in front of your house but want to get out of the useless grass growing business, there are many options for you to consider to keep that ground covered. Ground cover plants certainly need not be limited to grass. The very definition of ground cover from a landscaping perspective is a low-growing, low-maintenance, perennial spreading plant that keeps the ground from being bare. Note, this is actually a different plant than a cover crop, so don't get the terms mixed up. Now, the world of plants that fit the ground cover bill is diverse and fascinating, and some are specialists where grass actually falls short. Do you have a shady area that's looking a bit naked? Maybe a slope too steep and eroding to support turf? Peruse this list of non-traditional, fabulous ground covers that might be exactly what you need. Let's start with oregano. Oregano grows in any USDA zone, and it is probably one of the most delicious ground covers. Yes, that same oregano that makes your pizza sauce sing could also be a lawn replacement. This perennial herb grows beautifully in full sun in any zone, but it does best in areas with warm weather and well-draining soil. Though any type of oregano will do, try finding creeping oregano, O vulgare humiliae, for a low-growing, mat-forming variety. Oregano can tolerate some foot traffic, but won't put up with heavy use for long, so plant it where you can enjoy the scent without stomping on it too much. Number two, maybe this is the best ground cover to harvest as a tea, and it is chamomile. It grows best in USDA zones 4 through 9. Chamomile releases the scent of apple and daisies with every foot fall, and if you live in zones 4 to 9, you could easily grow that beauty to cover your yard. Interestingly, the plant historically used to cover those smooth castle fields of opulence wasn't the Kentucky bluegrass of modern suburbs, but chamomile and thyme. Now, chamomile loves both full and dappled sun and requires very little mowing, which results in a dense cover dazzled with those starry white blossoms. Camellium nobile is a creeping variety that is lawn suitable. A dwarf, non-flowering variety, C. nobile trenegeugi, will give you a fragrant, dense evergreen mat that some say is the perfect lawn replacement. In order to get a chamomile lawn established, you'll need to remove the grass. They can't tolerate competition very well. And be sure the soil is a bit airy too. Clay and rocky soils aren't their cup of tea, haha. Chamomile can be stepped on reasonably once it's established, at least after 12 weeks, but it will show signs of wear if it's trodden daily. Number three, thyme. This one grows great in zones 5 through 8, and it is a very drought-tolerant ground cover. If you don't have time to mow your lawn regularly, perhaps it's time to replace it with thyme, if you'll forgive me for that atrocious sentence. Consider transforming part of your landscape into an aromatic thyme garden. Thyme is drought tolerant, often used in the sizzling heat of full sun rock gardens, and available in a huge array of scents, leaf patterns, and bloom colors. They're hardy through zones 5 and 8. Those growers in zone 5 may find that thyme won't survive the winter as perennials. It may take a bit longer to get established, but once it does, it should be pretty much hassle-free. For areas where you intend to walk, look for creeping varieties like Thymus praecox, coccineus, or woolly thyme, Thymus pseudolengonunosus. Also, if you have children running around your yard, the sensitive, delicate beauty of many types of ground covers won't be able to handle those active games. No need to bar kids from being outside, though, just plant appropriately. Both thyme and clover, which is our next plant, can handle walking, running, and somersaults. White clover. This one grows great in USDA zones 3 through 10, it's low maintenance, and it's pollinator friendly. Clover may be seen as a weed in a traditional lawn, but what if it was the whole lawn? White clover is a super low maintenance, fantastic for pollinators, thrives in drought, doesn't grow tall, smells amazing, and won't need to be watered or fertilized. As a legume, it's a nitrogen fixer, so you can think of it as creating its own fertilizer. It grows beautifully in sun or partial shade, and isn't picky about soil quality. Now, there are two downsides that I see to clover. The first is that it is a little less durable than a grass lawn, but this can be easily remedied by planting grass and clover together. They'll back each other up and give you a surface that'll take the worst of what your kids and dogs can throw at it. The second downside is that it's considered invasive in the United States. White clover is originally a native of Europe. I have somewhat ambivalent feelings about its invasiveness, however, as it is a fantastic fodder crop, wonderful for bees, and in my opinion, far better than grass alone. There's absolutely no chance of eradicating white clover. But if you're intending to plant an entirely native patch on your land, be aware that clover does spread and isn't likely to go away anytime soon. And as a side note, be sure you're planting white clover. Red clover, while edible and medicinal, grows to be feet taller than the comfortable strolling height of its more diminutive cousin. Lily turf. This one grows great in zones 4 through 10, and it is a very grass-like ground cover. It's also called monkey grass, although there's a totally different family of plants that also shares that common name. And lily turf, this easy care perennial is a fantastic choice for borders and those awkward areas of ground between sidewalks on the road or around trees. If you don't need to have a yard for kickball games, you could even plant this flowering relative of narcissus in the whole yard. It forms a dense cover that barely requires maintenance. It's actually damaged most by overwatering and certainly doesn't need to be mowed, although it's not a plant that you should plan on walking over. You can grow it in full sun or partial shade in zones 4 through 10 and enjoy your extra time without lawn maintenance. There are a few different varieties of liriope, including L. muscari, which is a clumping variety, L. gigantea, which is a giant variety, and L. spicata, which is a spreading variety. Sweet woodruff. This one grows great in zones 4 through 8, and it might be a really good ground cover if you have acidic soil. Many of us probably have some evergreen trees with bare spots surrounding their bases. There are some plants, however, that can thrive in that environment, particularly if your pines and spruces are open enough to let some light hit the ground. We've put a link in the description box below that has a list of native plants that tolerate acid soils. If you pick wild ginger or wintergreen, by the way, they're also bonus plants because they're edible. But also useful for those shady acid areas is sweet woodruff. This European beauty is non-native, but a very pretty ground cover that gives off an attractive aroma and grows in the shades from zones 4 through 8. With starry compound leaves and delicate white flowers, it can fill that bare patch with grace. Care for this plant is simple. It doesn't need to be watered, fertilized, or really messed with, except for keeping its runners contained. Like all the creeping plants on this list, it can invade surrounding areas if left unchecked. Creeping Charlie. It grows great in USDA zones 5 through 9, and it is a very fast-growing ground cover. Now listen, I know, this name makes it seem like there's a mustachioed man secretly staring at you from a 15-passenger van, but this pretty ground cover deserves a better reputation and a better name. Many people spend a lot of effort trying to poison it out of their lawns as a weed, which was truly a shame because this weed does great as a lawn in its own right. It's low-growing with purple and green foliage, it's medicinally useful, it's pleasantly flowered with little purple blooms, and it's able to flourish in the shade. An issue with ground ivy, as this plant is also known, is keeping its invasive nature contained. If you are interested in growing only native plants in a certain area, be on your guard against their aggressive runners. Also, it's apparently toxic to horses, so plan accordingly. Moss. This one grows everywhere and is probably one of the most shade-tolerant ground covers. Recreate that dreamy, dense carpet of spongy green that covers forest floors with a moss bed all your own. These soft-to-walk-on carpets require no mowing and can even tolerate some foot traffic, but if you're going to be trampling them a lot, I would recommend using flagstones for their heavy use areas and letting moss fill in the gaps with their luscious green. Moss does require some specific situations for its best growth. The optimal choice for your area are the native types that want to grow there anyway, so you'll have to do some local research. But don't harvest mosses from the wild. If you can, try to harvest them from your own lawn, because they're probably there already, and use that as your base. You can use a blender to make a moss slurry to propagate them, or to use as green graffiti, but that's a whole different topic. Generally, mosses need acid soils, compact earth, shade, and enough moisture to keep them from drying out and turning brown. Lithodora. This ornamental takes a few years to spread out, but Kane here at Instedding is a big fan of it because it does a great job of blocking weeds. The bluish-purple flowers show color much of the year in the Pacific Northwest and do a good job of attracting pollinators as well. While the 4-inch or gallon pots you buy at the store will say these spread 24 to 36 inches wide, we've seen them spread up to 5 feet in diameter after 4 to 6 years. It spreads in a thick carpet shape and will cascade nicely over rockeries and planter edges. It grows too tall to serve as a pathway, but does a good job of withstanding foot traffic if you do walk on it. And for the final choice on our list, let the meadow return. Maintaining a traditional lawn is a lot of work. You're essentially forcing a monoculture to exist on land that wants to be anything but that. So if you have the space for it, and the freedom to do what you want on your land without your HOA getting their panties in a bunch, consider returning the majority of your land back to what it was originally. For many of us, this could be a prairie, a meadow, or a desert xeriscape, depending on your location. This return could be as simple as just letting nature do its thing on your property. The birds will poop out some local seeds, the wind will carry in others, and eventually, you'll start seeing more variety than boring old grass. Now, if you want to return your land to a healthy biodiverse zone of totally native plants, however, you'll need to take out the old and bring in the new. Some beautiful and useful plants just can't get a foothold if grass and clover are in the way. You'll need to research what local native plants could live in your area. Websites like Grow Native can help you rediscover what your land once grew. Meadows benefit from being mowed or scythed only twice a year, so the weekly task of mowing the lawn is one you won't need to put on your to-do list. Instead, you can welcome the host of butterflies, bees, other pollinators, and birds that benefit benefit from the food-rich habitat you've returned to your patch of earth. For more information and motivation to convert at least part of your land into a beautiful meadow, check out our article on insitting by Cheryl Magar. We may have inherited a legacy of carefully nursing non-native grasses into bizarre artificial carpets of featureless green, but we don't need to accept that as our lawn fate. Make your yard more than just an obsolete status symbol and transform it into something beautiful, aromatic, edible, and biodiverse. So, have any of you dared to spurn convention and gotten rid of your lawns for something better? And if you've had to deal with an HOA, what were your strategies for trying to make them see the light? Talk about it in the comments below and share the conversation.